No, the FBI didn't fucking know.
That's the problem.
It's going to reflect on Johnson or Humphrey.
Johnson. Humphrey didn't do it.
Humphrey didn't do it. Oh, hell.
He was bugging Humphrey, too.
Yeah, I let this keep you or your colleagues from concentrating on the big game.
Unless someone's giving $900,000.
That's right, which could be
may be getting $900,000 from somebody.
From two or three, I mean, he may have some big angels. I don't think he's getting a hell of a lot of small money. I don't believe this crap. I mean, if you could have your post office check in.
That junk sent you, I don't know. Mr. Speaker.
Yeah. I suppose the other area we're going to see some publicity on in the coming weeks, because I think half of the, now the indictments are down, there's going to be a cresting on that. The whitewash charge, of course, but I think we handle that well. The civil cases in advance, the patent hearings, this banking heresy committee, we've got to, whether we'll be successful or not, turn that off, I don't know. We've got a plan whereby Rob Black and Bittman, who are counsel for the five men who were, for a national total seven that were indicted today, are going to go up and visit every member, say, in the commence hearing, if you're going to jeopardize the civil rights of these individuals in the worst way, if they'll ever get a fair trial and like, and try to talk to members on that level.
Why not ask that they request to be heard? That's by the committee, so the public.
Publicly, they plan, what they're going to say is if you do commence with these hearings, we plan to publicly come up and say what you're doing to the rights of individuals.
But as a matter of fact, they could even make a motion in court to get the thing dismissed.
That's another thing we're doing is just trust the hearing, bring the injunctive action against the appearance of, say,
dismissal of the.
How about the fact that their criminals case, criminals charges dismissed on the grounds that they're voting on
the civil rights type stuff?
Civil rights, well, that's where, again, we've got somebody that's approaching the ACLU for these guys, to have them go up and exert some pressure, because we just don't want stands up there in front of the cameras with Patman and Patman asking all these questions. It's just going to be the whole thing, the press going over and over and over again. One suggestion was that Conley is close to Patman, and probably if anybody could talk turkey with Patman, Conley might be able to. I don't know if that's a good idea or not. Sherry Ford has not really taken an active interest in this matter, but it's developing, so Stan can go see Sherry Ford and try to brief him and explain some of the problems he's got. And then the other thing we're going to do is we're looking at all the campaign reports of every member of that committee, if we're convinced none of them probably fully comply with the law either. And if they want to get into it, if they want to play rough, somebody would dare say, well, gentlemen, we think we have to call your attention. You haven't complied, you see, you have, and we're not going to hold that secret if you start talking campaign violations too.
What about the board? Nixon? Do you meet with Nixon? Conley can't, they set up their head of Conley.
Conley, but it can do an aid chapter. If the board can get the minority members together on that one, it's going to be.
Well, they got a very weak man in Whitnall, unfortunately. Hector's all right.
Hector was great.
She was great with it.
That's what I understand. But you see, Whitnall, just maybe somebody, Jerry, can talk to him. Put it down. Jerry should talk to Whitnall. And just crazy for telling him to go to that house and start behaving. Not letting me the chairman.
Actually, Ron, that would be very helpful to get our minority side at least together on that.
Jerry, you've got to lead on this. It's got to be really
I'm sure he should. Now, this is exactly the thing he was talking about, that the reason they're saying in is so they can run investigations.
Well, the point is that they ought to raise hell about this, and that this, these hearings are jeopardizing the. I don't know that the council called the members of the committee was much good. It may be all right, but I was thinking that they really have to blunderbuss them in a public arena. Publicized,
right?
That's what this is, public relations.
That's all it is, particularly if Patton folks brings up that. That's the last forum that looks like it could be a problem. We have the least control of the way it stands right now. Kennedy's also suggested he may call hearings of his administrative practice and procedure subcommittee. As this case has been all along, you can spin out horribles that you can conceive of, and so we just don't do that. I stopped doing that about 2 months ago. We just take one time to deal with it based on.
And you really can't just sit and worry yourself about it all the time. Things, the worst may happen, but it may not. So you just try to button it up as well as you can and hope for the best. And remember that basically the damn thing is just one of those unfortunate things. Trying to cut our effect on you. That's the good thing.
It really has.
It hasn't.
It's been kept away from the White House almost completely and from the president totally. The only tie to the White House has been the Colson effort they keep trying to haul in.
And now, of course,
that's falling apart.
Two former White House people low level indicted, one consultant and one member of the domestic council staff. That's not very much of a time.
No.
Well, their names have been already mentioned. Stop. started to pose it. He's quite a character. He was getting into the second life of members of the DNC. And probably was a justification.
Well, he's working on an entrapment theory that they were hiding something, or they had secret information affairs to hide, and they had some way conspired to bring this thing about themselves. It's a way out theory that no one had cut it out.
He had scheduled Patricia Harris, and she didn't show up. She went to the beauty parlor instead, so he went down to the courthouse, and she had been directed to show up. Then the next day, the judge cut all the depositions off. But he had a host of wild questions, including, you know, where Ryan got his compensation when he was chairman. Not that he knows anything about that, but just an interesting question he thought he might want to ask the chairman under oath.
That's it. Gives us the same hunting license that it gave them. That's so we can play the same game they're playing, but we ought to be able to do better at it. Are those depositions sealed?
That's right.
They are?
But that argues that they won't want them unsealed. They'll want them unsealed less than we will. We made the argument at some point to get them unsealed.
Right.
I think what's going to happen on the civil case is the judge is going to dismiss the pending complaint down there right now. They will then turn around and file a new complaint, which will be for come back to Richie again. That'll probably happen the 20th, 21st, 22nd. Then 20 days will run until any answers will have to be filed, any depositions will be commenced. So we're eating up an awful lot of time.
But on their side,
why will they have to dismiss the president? Probably on a new ground, both on the substantive ground, they have a stated good cause of action, that there's improper class action filed, that O'Brien indeed doesn't represent any class. And he'll just dismiss it on the merits. It's not a good complaint. He's already shaded down to almost nothing on his original order. They will then have to redesign it in a much narrower action. But the judge himself can suggest something to counsel that you've got a good race judicata argument here. If he dismisses on the merits, they can't file another suit. They're out of the court totally.
But our suit still hangs.
Our suit would still, we have two suits, and we have the visa process and the life of our suit.
We can take depositions on both of those?
Absolutely.